Then she started to cry, tried to gather in her shaky sobs, tea spilling into her saucer, but they came like seizures. Anita took Marjorie's cup and saucer from her and rubbed her shoulders, which made Marjorie cry harder while trying to haul tranquility from the air, saliva and tears and snot running off her chin and body, jerking in silent sobs. Anita got a damp face washer and Marjorie held it to her face. But her grief didn't stop. She spluttered on and on for the first time in decades. Anita sighed, ripped off her Nicorette patch, and sat on the back step smoking until Marjorie's shudders stopped. When she'd assembled her steely demeanour again, Anita stubbed out her cigarette and made a fresh pot of tea. Marjorie was able to sip her tea, though she couldn't get her mouth to work enough to eat the yo-yo. "You're very kind," she managed to say, and Anita smiled. "I suppose they teach you that at home care school."
"Yep," Anita said. "Otherwise, we'd never know."
"Normally I don't cry," Marjorie said. "It's been a tragic week and I missed my hair appointment."
"What you need, apart from new glasses, is a flatmate."
"Are you sure you're not Irish?" Marjorie asked. She shook her head.
"Never seen an invisible pixie in my life. Why?"
"Well, I've got a flatmate, an invisible friend." Anita looked around the kitchen, past Marjorie, down the passage, and said,